Hello. I thought maybe this layout might need a little tiny bit of explanation, because it's now for something completely different. We've gone back 100 years to Vienna. Since from the beginning of my career, I've always tried to find out what a composer really wanted and tried to play the music the way he might have hoped. So this layout is part of that arrangement. You need to get the right number of players, and the balance between the wind and the strings is very important. When I was a student in the 50s, Beethoven was often played by very, very large orchestras, but no more woodwind to balance it necessarily, and often at very slow tempi. You remember the sort of thing. It was very grand, very impressive. But of course, Beethoven isn't an early Wagner. He's a late Haydn. He's Haydn on drugs. Very good drugs, I think. Expensive drugs. So he needs to be taken seriously as an 18th century composer. And this is the size of the Vienna Opera Orchestra in Mozart and Beethoven's time. 8 first violins, 8 second violins. They always played opposite each other, in Mahler, in Brahms, in Mozart, and Haydn. That's another thing they used to do, is have all the violins on the same side, didn't they, in the 50s. But you get a wonderful dialogue. You'll hear the dialogue very strongly between the first and seconds. Another dialogue between trumpets and horns. And the basses are right in the middle. So the standing woodwind around the edge is slightly my idea, but it's also an interpretation of various layouts, which we know from the late 18th and early 19th centuries. So numbers are important, layout is important. Every aspect of the score we tried to look at when we recorded these Beethoven symphonies in the 80s with the London Classical Players, that Beethoven is a revolutionary composer. But we created another revolution in our recordings. It made quite an impression at the time. You've probably forgotten about them by now, but there we are. It still was very, very exciting. So one of the other things that we looked at and we still look at here today is in Beethoven's time, they didn't play with that funny wobbling stuff, you know, the wobbly vibrato. And you probably noticed we didn't use it in the Debussy either. It came in France, 1915, 1918, around there, and in England, same sort of time. So it's not very relevant for 1890, but certainly not relevant for Beethoven. Even more important, lastly, is tempo. Beethoven knew the developer of the metronome, Mälzel, and Mälzel gave him a copy of his new instrument for measuring time. I think it was around 1812. And Beethoven thought it was wonderful that you could fix the idea of the speed. He said, with the use of this instrument, my music will live in the future. He little knew that most conductors wouldn't take any notice at all and did whatever they liked. But I find it fascinating to do what the composer says, and then play as well as you possibly can. In other words, combine information with fantasy, fact with fantasy. Not just go down the fantasy road or try to be terribly scholarly and boring. So the metronome, there's a metronome mark for every single movement of Beethoven symphonies, and I regard them as a part of the score. Not to be fooled around with. They're not recommendations from the associated board. We think it might be nice if you played it at 78. No, they are what Beethoven wanted. So I think it's exciting. I think this evening we'll be playing as close to that as we can, and you'll hear two good examples would be the first two movements. The first movement is frighteningly fast. incredibly fast. People tried to make it noble in the early 20th century, but it's not noble. It's bloody buying. It's a battle. Of course, heroes are made in battles, and the underlying rhythm is a galloping horse. Everybody knew how fast horses galloped, and the violins certainly now know how fast they gallop. And if you do it really slowly and grandly, the horse sounds rather pathetic. Tuk-a-tuk, 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 tuk-a-tuk. I've never seen a horse gallop at that speed. So that's you hear it rushing from one side to the other in the first movement. It's very, very frightening. It's a battle. You either kill or you are killed. It's horrible. It's terrifying. But in between, you get these wonderful moments of sorrow. Your friend has just been killed, and you feel full of sadness. This keeps recurring. A battle and then a time off to mourn the dead. So that the tempo is crucial. If you go too slow, it doesn't sound frightening, it sounds rather grand. The second movement, likewise, the tempo is extremely important. It's a funeral march, but marches are always in two. One, two. One, two. One, two. Or a funeral march, one, two. One, two. And that's the speed of this second movement. It was not an easy weeping movement, but a movement of a nation feeling a grief too deep for tears, too noble. You've taken one of my sons, take the other. It's that kind of terrifying 1914-18 feeling, you know, a nation in grief, but can't waste it on tears. So there's something very grand about it as well. Okay. So the tempo again is very, very important, and he tells you exactly what speed to go. The other movements are the same, but those two are particularly important. So we try to play the music, whether on old instruments or modern instruments, as an audience would have expected to hear it, the very beginning of the 19th century. There's one thing which would really puzzle an old audience if they time traveled to be in here, to be in a modern concert hall. And that's the strange silence between the movements. They wouldn't have understood why people are being silent. They clapped, of course, every movement, unless it was a very sad movement. Maybe they wouldn't have clapped the funeral march, but they'd have clapped the others. Of course they would. And that went on until Debussy's time. Went on until 1920 or so. It was really quite recent that it changed. So, if you feel like it, you know. Might be. It's more interesting than just being silent and going, oh yeah, yeah. Now what? So if you want to join in and be terribly historical, you don't have to wear wigs or anything. You're allowed to wash. But anyway, if you do feel like it, do. Meanwhile, here we go into battle. Please fasten your safety belts.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.